So, it's been a busy few days at Arsenal with all stuff going on behind the scenes. In this video, I just bring you all up to date with what's going on. Hello, I'm Richard and welcome back to my channel Over and Over and Over Again, which features everything to do with Arsenal. Now, in this video, I just really want to look at some of the issues that's been going on at the club over the last couple of days. There's been quite a lot of stuff going on. I just really wanted to keep you up to date with everything that's happening. Just before I get into all that, I just want to make sure that you're all subscribing to the channel. I'm very, very close now to 100 subscribers, which is my first main milestone, if you like. I'm getting close to that now, so it'd be really nice if I could get there before the start of the season. At the weekend would be great. So if you haven't subscribed yet, please click on the subscribe button below. If you have and you're enjoying the videos, please give this video the thumbs up as well. And I say tune in as well, because later on this evening I've got a live show. It's my first podcast. It's going to be called the Positive Arsenal Podcast, because we're looking at some positivity, trying to keep the positivity going through the season on this channel if we can. That's coming live tonight, 7 o'clock UK time, where I'll have some special guests joining me as well. So please tune in for that as well. So where do we start with all this over the last couple of days? There's been a lot happening. I think the biggest issue for me, and certainly the most worrying, has been the injury to David Luiz. It's rumoured now that he could be out for as long as 6 weeks. It's a neck injury, and it's apparently a recurring of an old injury that he's had. Now, this is actually quite a concern for me, because not only did he play well towards the end of last season, but also as well, it's the leadership qualities that he's shown both on the pitch and off the pitch. And without that, I think we're going to really we're going to miss that, because there's no one else, I don't feel, that we've got in the squad who can step in, certainly on the pitch, and take on that leadership at the back. Also as well, the other side of it is, now some of the players who maybe were going to be leaving the club to bring in some funds to help strengthen other areas of the team, such as the midfield, may now have to stay as cover, because if David Luiz isn't going to be fit until after the close of the transfer window, then that does present us with a problem there as well. The first name, of course, that springs to mind in that was Rob Holding, who was rumoured to be going out on loan for the season to Newcastle. Now it seems as though he's going to be staying as cover for David Luiz for the first few games, and he may well stay now for the season as well, and fight for a place in the team. For me, that's not bad news really. If he's going to be playing, he needs to get some regular game time, doesn't he? So we don't know how that's going to work out with the new defenders that we've bought, but we'll see. But it seems as though Rob Holding is now going to stay at the club. Some of the other defenders who were maybe on the verge of leaving, Socrates perhaps, there was interest from him. Will the club still want to sell him? Now we've got David Luiz out, we don't know. We're going to have to see what happens with that. But we do need to raise some funds to bring in some of the players that we need. So for me though, this is a blow, because I think he was our best defender, certainly towards the end of last season, David Luiz. And to be without him for 6 weeks, I do feel as though that could be really, really crucial for us, and that's a big blow. So let's hope the injury is not as bad as been rumoured, and that he can be back sooner than that. But it seems he's certainly going to miss the first game of the season at Fulham now on Saturday, which I say is not good news at all. I suppose the next thing we need to, someone who's been in the news actually quite a lot throughout this pre-season has been Hector Bellerin. It seems as though Barcelona have now come in with a bid for him, believed to be around 25 million. If you remember, PSG have approached the club for him as well, and Bayern Munich were showing interest. So despite the fact that he seemed to take a lot of criticism from Arsenal fans, you know, three of the biggest clubs in Europe have expressed an interest in him this summer. And this Barcelona move now seems more likely to happen, I believe. Especially now it seems Ainsley Maitland-Niles is going to stay at the club. He can possibly take over as first choice on the right, as right back or right wing back. We've got Cedric Suarez as cover, so maybe we're okay in that position now. Maybe this is a good time for Bellerin to move on. We can get 25 million for him, or possibly try to get a bit more. And then obviously we can put that money towards some of the other players that we need. This could be a good move for Hector as well, going back of course to Barcelona, where he came from at 16 years old. Didn't need to come across to London to play for us. So maybe his time at Arsenal's come to an end. It'd be a shame, you know. I like the guy, and I think he's been a good player for us over the years, but maybe this is now the right time. I wasn't so sure the other day when maybe there was a bit more doubt about Ainsley staying, but now it seems as though Ainsley is staying. Maybe now we can cash in on Hector to bring in the money where we need to spend it. So it seems as though that, I say, Barcelona, he could be going back there. So we'll keep an eye on that one, but that seems as though that could be happening. Another player that could well be leaving the club now is Emi Martinez. Of course, Aston Villa are really stepping up their attempts to buy him. They're saying they really want him in place for their first league match of the season, which is, of course, a week after. So it's basically a week on Saturday, their first game, because, of course, their game this weekend's been postponed. Apparently, Martinez has refused a new contract with Arsenal. Aston Villa have bid 20 million for him now. This is quite a strange one, really, because a few months ago, I don't think anybody would have had any complaints if Emi Martinez left the club. No one would have really missed him. He hadn't played very much at all, had he, in the 10 years he'd been there. And suddenly he's had 15, 20 games at the end of last season where he performed really, really well, brilliant performances. And suddenly now there's a big clamour to keep him. If he doesn't want to sign a contract and he's not prepared to stay and fight for his place with Bert Leno, maybe we should sell him. I think he needs to understand that, you know, Bert Leno was the number one goalkeeper, and just because he came in and performed well doesn't automatically mean he should get the number one spot. They both, you know, it needs to be fought for, doesn't it? And if he's not prepared to do that, he just wants to get a first team place somewhere else, then maybe he needs to go. It'd be a shame because he clearly loves the club, and he did have some great games at the end of the season. But again, if 20 million is probably a decent price for a goalkeeper, let's face it, it's been second choice at our club for a number of years. It's gone out on loan several times, never managed to establish himself. And if we can get 20 million for him now on the back of maybe 10, 15 good games, then that's probably a good deal for us. Where that leaves us in terms of a second choice goalkeeper, there are rumours that apparently PSG have offered us their goalkeeper, Alfonso Areola, to come in on loan, so that could solve that problem. And again, it means we haven't got to spend that money on a transfer fee either if it's a loan deal. So this again is something that I think will happen as well over the next few days, next week or so. So we need to keep an eye on that. Other news as well, apparently Matteo Guendouzi has been training with the first team squad again. He seems to be back in the fold. Has he got his head down and put his attitude right? We'll have to wait and see. But certainly Arteta said he was giving everybody a clean slate, didn't he, for the start of the season, and maybe that's true in the case of Guendouzi, and maybe he will be back in the squad at least as we move into the new season. If he can get his head down and perform well on the pitch, I don't think anybody's got any problems with that. It's obviously his attitude's been the issue, and if he can sort that out, then it'd be good to have him back in the squad. Again, it's an area of the pitch, isn't it? The midfield that we are slightly short of quality. And if he can step up, then, you know, maybe you might have to now if some of these other deals can't go ahead. You know, the Thomas Partey deal in particular, he might have to step in and do the job there, especially now that we've lost the opportunity to buy Abdoulaye Doucouré, also a player that I've been really championing over the past couple of years. Finally, there's some good news as well. I mean, we need to have some good news to end on, really. First of all, I just want to congratulate Ainsley Maitland-Niles on his full England debut this week. Of course, in Denmark, he came on late in that game for Trent Alexander-Arnold, played in the right wing-back position briefly. So a great achievement for him to get his first England cap. Hope it's the first of many. He certainly deserves it. He deserved his call-up. And now I say, with this Hector Bellerin situation with him maybe leaving, it could be a good opportunity for Ainsley to really establish himself in the first team at Arsenal in that right wing back position, make that position his own, and he can really push on for England as well. So congratulations to him. Also as well, another player who's done really well at international level the last week or so is Eddie Nketiah, for the under 21s, having scored a hat-trick in Kosovo last weekend, which I featured in a video earlier this week. He actually scored again on I think it was on Tuesday night for the under 21s away in Austria in a game they won 2-1. That means he's now scored 12 goals for the under 21s, which is just one behind Alan Shearer's all-time record. So hopefully Eddie can get that record, and that would be a great achievement for him. Actually, it's worth noting his goal scoring record actually at England youth levels is unbelievable. For the under 18s, under 19s, under 20s, and now the under 21s, he's played 21 times across all four different age group levels, and he's scored 31 goals. That's a phenomenal goal scoring record. And hopefully now with a new season starting, he's obviously fresh, he's sharp, scoring goals. So let's hope he can bring that form into the new season in the Premier League when we get going. And of course, with rumours that maybe Alexander Lacazette may be leaving as well, maybe Eddie's now ready to step in And you know, get us some goals in the first team as well. He did score a few towards the end of the season, and I'm sure at the moment he must be buzzing with his performances for England. So again, congratulations to Eddie for that great record, and let's hope he can actually get the goal scoring record for the under 21s, take it off Alan Shearer. It's about time Alan Shearer had a record taken off him, isn't it? So come on Eddie, have a couple of goals for the under 21s and put Alan Shearer away. That's what we need to do. So that's that for now. So I just really want to catch up with bits and pieces that's going on at the club really over the last few days. Quite a lot of stuff happening there. I hope you liked that video. If you did, please give it a thumbs up. Please subscribe to my channel. And I say tune in again later on this evening, 7 p.m. UK time, for my first podcast show I'm hosting, which is going live at 7 o'clock tonight. It's called the Positive Arsenal Podcast, because I'm going to try and keep things positive. Got some great guests as well. There'll be links going up on social media throughout the day as well, so you can click on the links there. You can see who my guests are going to be. Really excited about that. We've got some great stuff to talk about, obviously, with a new season starting, and lots of other stuff that's been in the news as well, with, you know, the clubs losing money on sponsorship deals and all that kind of stuff. And also as well, of course, the latest news from the government with the new restrictions in place. It seems now unlikely that fans will be allowed into the stadiums from October as we were originally hoping. So there's still no definite news on that yet, but when we get that in, no doubt, if we've got a bit more stuff about that, we may even mention that tonight and on the podcast as well. So lots to talk about, so hope you can tune in for that. Say 7 o'clock UK time for the Positive Arsenal Podcast, the first of many hopefully that we'll be doing throughout the season. And I say hope you enjoyed this video as well. So that's it for today then. Hope you enjoyed that. Remember, tune in tonight from 7 o'clock if you can. If not, it'll be on YouTube. It'll be replayed on YouTube anyway after that. So hopefully you can catch up with that. And I say, please subscribe to my channel. Help me get to 100 if we can before the weekend. That would be fantastic. So thanks for watching. Thanks for everyone who's supported the channel so far. And of course, in the meantime, as always, come on, you Gunners!